Hello, this presentation is going to consider experimental design as it pertains to the study of statistics. And essentially what we're doing with an experiment is designing a way to collect data. So we're designing a statistical study, meaning we intend to gather data that will be analyzed, interpreted, and so forth. So the guidelines of experimental research include the following. We need to identify the variables of interest and the population that we're wishing to study, and we have to define both very clearly and specifically. Two, we need to develop a plan for collecting data. Will we be asking people to fill out a questionnaire? Will we be observing particular behaviors? If you use a sample, we have to make sure that it's representative of the population if we wish to make inferences. And that's usually a desirable quality of research. After we've developed those initial steps, we then can move into collecting the data, describing the data, and finally interpreting the data. And interpreting the data can mean making decisions about the population using inferential statistics. And that's if we have decided to take a representative random sample. Finally, we finish this process by identifying any possible errors that may have occurred. There are many different ways that scientists gather data. One is observation, where we simply record the occurrence of different phenomena, different characteristics of a population. And a lot of times, if you're doing social science, for instance, you'd be looking for a particular behavior. Because behaviors are something we can observe, and it's more difficult, for example, to observe somebody's attitude. If we wanted to understand somebody's attitude, we'd probably want to conduct a survey, because a survey would involve asking them questions, which would then allow us to measure their attitudes. Sometimes we're more intentional about producing a particular set of behaviors, and that's more common in the social sciences or in the field of medicine. Perhaps we want to see how effective a drug treatment is, or something along those lines. Finally, a simulation is the use of a model to reproduce the conditions of a situation or process. And so we can run simulations. That's common in the field of meteorology, for instance, where they simulate weather patterns. We've mentioned the importance of sampling to conducting research, but we haven't gone into the specific types of sampling that we can do. And one of those is what we would call stratified sampling, where before we start sampling from a population, we first divide that population into subpopulations. So if we wanted to study college students, for instance, let's say we wanted to have a representative sample of all the different class levels. So we would have freshmen, sophomores, juniors, and seniors. If we didn't first divide the college student population into these categories, what we would wind up with would be perhaps imbalanced collection of subsamples, depending on the proportional makeup of these classes at a particular college. So at a college, for instance, that receives a lot of transfers, you're going to have an underrepresentation of freshmen and sophomores. So stratified samples ensures you have a fair representation of a set of different subpopulations. Another method of sampling is what we call cluster sampling. And here we randomly select from naturally occurring subgroups. You could imagine this as a map of neighborhoods, for instance, and this would involve perhaps a two-level approach to sampling, where we would first randomly sample neighborhoods, and then perhaps if there's maybe a lot of houses in each neighborhood, we would then randomly select houses on each street. And that would provide one way of randomizing our sampling. Finally, systematic sampling involves just skipping every nth number of cases in a population. So if we have, for instance, names in a phone book, and let's say there are 10,000 names in the phone book, but we only want a sample of 1,000, well, we would skip every 10th person, and we would get to 1,000 by doing that. It's important also to be aware of the fact that not all sampling is random, and if we're not using random sampling, then we're not doing something appropriate for inferential statistics. But nevertheless, there are some cases and reasons why one might use non-random sampling techniques, and one of those that's commonly used is a convenience sample. And a convenience sample consists only of people who are available from a population to participate in a research study. So let's say you want to know the number of years of education each teacher has at your college. What you might do is stand out in the quad, and when somebody walks by who looks to be a teacher, you might ask them questions about their education. And this would be a convenience sample. Now, you could try to add some randomization by perhaps visiting different departments. You randomly select two different departments and survey each teacher in those departments. You could select only teachers you currently have this semester, but again, that would probably skew things towards the type of major you're taking. Or you could divide teachers up according to their department and choose and survey some teachers in each department, and perhaps you randomly select within department. So there are ways to try to add randomness, and the more randomness we have in our sampling methods, the better. And those methods we just mentioned involve examples of cluster sampling, convenience sampling, and stratified sampling. Thanks for watching.